1, 2, 3, 4. From We Are Spectacular, this is a Spectacular Marketing Podcast. A podcast about everything brand, marketing, digital and social for the food and drink industry and beyond. It's a really grey and wet morning in the heart of Fitzrovia in Charlotte Street, and I'm sitting in a little cafe that serves crepes and coffee. It's really interesting because I've seen so many missed sales opportunities when people have been ordering their breakfast. People are coming in and not sure what the concept is and then just walking out again, probably heading along to an eat or a pret, something that's a bit more familiar. However, I've also seen people coming in having the coffee but not taking the food option because, again, they're not too sure that they want that for breakfast. And I think it's all about data, really understanding what customers want, when they want it, and marketing to that. So by only serving up crepes and coffee, they're really limiting their opportunity. Today, I've got the great pleasure of talking with Peter Martin. And Peter has been in the industry for around 35 years, and I really see him as the John Peel, the curator of this industry that we all work in and love. And he's really passionate about getting people together, sharing information, sharing insight, sharing data, sharing knowledge that's going to help your business be more successful. Peter's the Vice President of CGA, which is the wonderful insight company. And of late, he's also a director of CM & Co. He's also had many, many other business ventures over the years, a true entrepreneur in our sector and someone we all look up to. I've spent around an hour talking to Peter about his journey, what his thoughts are on the industry at present, and on top of that, where he thinks the industry's heading. So let's get straight into it. I hope you enjoy the episode. I'll speak to you in a bit. So today I've got a legend in the room. Room's probably a little bit of a stretch for this shed that we're in.
It is.
Recording. So, and you've picked up a cold, which sucks, just before Easter. So yeah, we're going to get hot and sweaty over the next 40 minutes or an hour, or however long we go. And yeah, I've got Mr. Peter Martin.
Good morning, sir. How are you? Pleased to see you again.
All the better for seeing you. So glad when I looked at my diary today in terms of what I was doing. It's just a fun day today. So
it's a good day. It's a good day to meet up.
Really excited about what you have to say. And I get the feeling it probably won't be the last time we talk in this format. And yeah, I think you've got lots more to say than you'll probably manage in the next little while. So, Peter, we've known each other for 10 years almost.
Maybe. Quite likely. I think it probably is.
Yeah, yeah. So
time goes by very quickly.
Definitely. So, yeah, I was just a wee boy, although there was nothing wee about me, but younger at Yo Sushi, and we sort of met there, really, and did a lot of fabulous work for us on insight and, you know, research, and also kind of giving me my first speaking gigs as well, which I've still not paid you for. So thanks for doing that. I really appreciate that. That's led to many great things. So my job today really is to be quiet and just listen to all the great things you've got to say, all the experience. So Peter, for those of you who don't know, Peter is the Vice President of CGA, and Peach is part of that as well.
It is indeed, yeah.
And director of CM & Co. So usually his initials are snuck in there somewhere with the ventures, which is fantastic. So so I think the best thing to do with someone with your experience and stories and, you know, living this industry for such a long time, I guess it's best to start at the start.
Well, I do go back 35 years, yes, roundabout in this industry, and I sort of fell into it as happens, because my background is in journalism. I was trained as a journalist. I started on regional newspapers up in Leicester, worked for Campaign for Real Ale for a short while, and then did a short stint at the Financial Times. And I'd been working sort of freelance stringer for Publican for a long while, and I got a call which basically said the editor's job's up, would you be interested? So I went to interview for it. I was 28 and got the job, I think mainly on the strength of the fact that I'd actually done a few shifts on The Sun, so I could write fairly good headlines. So I think that's probably the thing. swayed it. And also, being a journalist, one drinks. So the background. But that really was the start, and I've not moved away from the industry, the out of home market. It's such a great business to be in, and I've done a lot of things as an editor, columnist, commentator, media owner. We launched media publications ourselves, event organizer, and probably more recently as a consultant and dare I say, data geek I've become, yeah.
So with the glasses as well.
Well, exactly, and that's really with CJ. But that shows the growth of the market. I must admit, when I got into it, Publican was just a twice monthly magazine. So I edited that, and I actually great deal of experience because I managed to get part of a management buyout at that time when three of us in the management team bought out Publican and then Club Mirror newspaper to form a company called Quantum. So that got me into the wacky world of venture capital. So I got to know those guys, which is, you know, and one of the sets, those turning points, it's one of those things that you have opportunities to do stuff and you have to take them because you never know where that would have led me if I hadn't done that.
But I think the difference is 98% of people wouldn't have.
I don't know about that, but yeah. You know. So, yeah, I mean, and we launched. I went in as editorial director. That company grew. We bought things and helped launch things like the restaurant show, whatever is still going. You know, when those people sort of celebrate 25 years, you feel how old you are, but still. And from then on, I think, you know, Publican, we took Publican weekly on the back of the beer orders back in the mid-80s, which is actually probably one of the most seminal moments in not just the pub sector, but also the eating and drinking out market as a whole, because you're much too young to remember all this.
Yeah, I didn't know about this.
Well, yeah, I mean, basically, it was back in the day where brewers, big brewers owned pubs, most of the pubs, you know, large majority of the pubs in Britain. There was a Monopolies Mergers Commission investigation, which said, yes, there was. They were controlling beer supply through the pubs they owned and basically gave an ultimatum to those big six brewers that they had to shed pubs, sell off pubs if you wanted to keep owning breweries and introduce guest beers. And there was a number of things there. But I think the most important thing is it took a lot of time for that to filter through. There was a lot of lobbying with government. And at that time, that sell-off helped create a whole new generation of pub companies. Leased and tenanted companies like Enterprise Inns, which is still around, but probably more important, a lot of managed pub chains. And we've sort of the growth of even companies like Wetherspoons came on the back of that because there was a gap in the market. I think that changed the market quite dramatically. It also helped create a new trade body, which the Association of Licensed Multiple Retailers, ALMR, and I helped create that over a very good lunch because there was a lot of those entrepreneurial small pub chains, which are still driving this market, who had no voice. The Brewers Society wasn't right. The Licensed Vintners Association wasn't right for them. So we created this association, which now, even these last few months, has now merged with the British Hospitality Association to form this one big, great voice for the market in UK hospitality, which I'm still involved in on the advisory council.
And
so,
just on that point, like I remember seeing Kate at the Peach Conference,
yeah.
And Kate said something like a third of all jobs were created through, you know, hospitality and pubs, and you know, you as an outsider or Joe Public, you would never know that.
No, it's a phenomenal market actually, and I mean, there's a lot of work to be done on that because we certainly know the image of the industry is not great, particularly with older generations who wouldn't necessarily want their children or their grandchildren to go in it, which is wrong because there are great now career choices and career opportunities. Yes, it is hard work, it is antisocial hours at times, but it's great camaraderie, and actually you're giving people great experiences.
I think that's what drew me to the market, and I think through talking to you and you know, and being at Yo with Robin and the guys there, I suddenly realised I was in an industry that made people happy.
Yeah, and that is a fundamental thing. That's what it is all about. You know, food and drink are core to this market, but they're in a sense ancillary to a good night out. Yeah. You know, or a business lunch or a friends meeting, whatever. Yeah. And pubs and restaurants and cafes are really part of that. And that landscape over those last 30 years, to looking back, has changed changed dramatically. So as well as the beer orders, I think the other big change is the gradual change and liberalisation of licensing laws in this country, culminating in the 2003 Licensing Act. Because, you know, there was a day that you couldn't open on Sunday afternoons. Well, you couldn't open and afternoons in general. Kids weren't allowed in pubs. And all that loosening of licensing was helped the market considerably. And it's also brought restaurants into it. And now with the current licensing, pubs, restaurants have the same license,
yeah.
Same terms. It is not 24-hour opening. It is flexible, but it is still controlled. But it gives people more flexibility to do things. And I think that liberalisation has been good, along with a smoking ban. We do have families coming into pubs. It's a much more civilised environment probably than it was before,
yeah.
And that's helped by food. So you've got a lot of strands going on in this market. I think if you look at the business, in one sense, it's not rocket science, but what the difficult thing is, and now you admire the operators, is there are a lot of moving parts. And it's understanding all those moving parts, whether it's legislation, whether it's food, whether it's staff. There's a lot going on. Mm-hmm. And most importantly is understanding what the consumer wants and what they're thinking.
Yeah.
So it really is, in one sense, a really complex, but really enthralling business.
Yeah. And then, you know, just in terms of the whole wave of the fast casual, you know, industry starting, I mean, can you remember a point where you felt that had begun? What happened?
Well, I think in a sense, it's always been there, because one can argue with fast casual, it's you're using the technical definition. It's ordering at a bar for your food. Well, pubs have been doing that for years. So
that's
in
true.
A sense, it's nothing new. Yeah. And I think we have probably in the UK a less strict, a more flexible interpretation of what's fast casual, in that it's, you know, Yo could be in there, Wagamama's in that, because it is about speed and convenience. And I think for that, certainly that lunchtime period, that's really important. And I think consumers do want speed. They want ease of doing business, hassle-free experiences.
Yeah. But, you know, I'm thinking back to, you know, Bernie Inns and Pizza Express and, you know, and all that sort of stuff, you know. But was it a really slow, gradual thing? Do you think the explosions only happened in the last 15, 20 years, or, you know, what, in terms of the high street, kind of getting to grips with people want this stuff, you know?
In one sense, it's been gradual. I mean, I think you mentioned Pizza Express, which has been around a long while. But again, a very simple offer in the sense, you know, it's pizzas done very easily, because pizzas can be cooked very easily. It's international food, which has worked incredibly well. I think what's happened is that we have become gradually a country which eats out rather than drinks out. When I started it was really a country that drinks out, and drinking down the pub was always seen as, if anything was recession proof, it was drink.
Yeah,
you're going to the pub. And by the way, we've had more than one recession. Well, I've been through a few. But I think it's now eating out, because what we're seeing now is eating out is fairly flat, but it's steady. A lot of commentators now will say that you know, consumers are pulling in their spend on eating out. We don't see that at all. In fact, it's flat. We're not seeing it increase much, but actually it's part of what people do. So even over the last 3 years, frequency of eating out is remained incredibly stable. Issue now is choice, which comes back to what you're saying, is we've seen a lot of people coming into this market. Part of it is driven by finance and investment.
Yeah.
Because if people feel they can make money, we've seen private equity come into this market, and that has helped grow the sector, particularly in casual dining.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's like a blessing and a curse in a way, you know, in terms of without that fuel, people wouldn't be able to expand their brands as quickly and all the rest of it. But I think, you know, some of the venture capitalists out there, you know, as you say, it's a commercial opportunity more than a passion. And I think, like, the whole industry is just driven, really should be on passion. And I think, you know, this is where it looks like some brands are getting caught out now.
I think that's an interesting point. I think you probably need both because, you know, you've got to pay the bills.
Oh, sure, you've got to pay the
mortgage. Yeah. So, I mean, I think you do need a pretty hard-headed business approach to what you're doing. I mean, if you think it's a lifestyle and you want to come in for lifestyle, as long as you think hard work's part of lifestyle, fine. But otherwise, don't bother.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think, passion is important. I think you see the brands which have succeeded have got that. But it's more as well. I think it's also being close. It's not just doing what you want to do. It's also being close to what consumers are about and making it easy for those.
Mm.
Bit of research we did recently, actually, with CJ Research for their brand track. Again, we're always looking at what consumers are doing through satisfaction or whatever. And industry as a whole is always looking these days of ease of doing business. Because it's the internet age. People are shopping online. People want to do things quickly. So we thought, how do we measure this within the hospitality sector? And we just asked a simple question of, you believe those brands are hassle-free?
Yeah.
And it's interesting, the brands that come out in the top 10, amongst those top 10, are all the brands which are market leaders in their segment, and they're big brands. It's McDonald's. It's Wetherspoons. It's Greg's, it's Nando's, it's Toby in pub restaurants.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's quite interesting, and actually making life simple for consumers and making sure they feel it's easy is actually a great way to grow a brand.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, we're seeing a lot of people bucking against. It's really splitting the audience, the delivery side of things. And I think, at a conference a little while ago, I saw someone from John Lewis speaking, and he was fantastic. And they actually just talked about a really mature response in terms of dealing with digital or delivery or online, or, you know, and people are thinking, is that cannibalizing? Is that, you know, I've got to pay a cut to someone, you know, these kind of things. But actually with John Lewis, they just said, if there's an online order, if it's within X many miles of that store gets a credit. And I think they've been really sensible about how to cater for that. But I think, you know, my question is, you know, what are you seeing out in the market, you know, in terms of the people that are using delivery well? Is that an issue? Is that really helping their brand? Are they cannibalising? You know, what are you thinking?
Well, that's a big issue about deliveries here. It's working. People are taking advantage of it. It is helping to drive incremental sales. I think from Peach Business Tracker, again, one of those barometers we created some years back, which is still going strong, which is the industry barometer, we're looking around about an average only of 3% sales right across casual dining. Mm. However, there are certain brands where it's a lot higher, particularly urban-based brands and with probably a younger clientele. So it's an important part of the sector. The challenge, I think everyone's saying, is one, how do people make money out of it, whether it's the delivery side or the or the restaurant side, and who owns the brand, particularly with the experience, because if you're getting a cold pizza or you know, you're getting cold noodles, you know, who carries the can?
Yeah.
But I think it's a matter of understanding that and how the industry works together. I think it's going to be quite interesting. Mm. We're seeing delivery look at running their own kitchens, their own dark kitchens. Whether that's going to cause conflict with restaurants, I think is interesting, because I think that's starting to develop. I think we're in the early stages of this. Mm-hmm. Some restaurants have tried to do it themselves, but again, that's not their core skill. But then again, do you hand your brand over to
someone
else, delivery company? That's what I say about a lot of moving parts,
a lot
of things to take into consideration, which should be fairly simple. So I think there's a lot of working out to be done, and in terms of developing proper partnerships in the market.
Well, I think it's quite interesting. Ordered delivery a lot when I'm staying up in London. I'm very lazy like that. And one of the chaps nearly fell down the stairs when he was coming to my flat.
How high had they lived?
So that was quite interesting. I nearly had noodles everywhere. But I think the brand thing is interesting in terms of that consistent experience. Now, I think there's a couple of brands that deserve a bit of a shout out on their packaging and how it appears. I think Wagamama's is second to none.
Yeah,
there's a lot of plastic, but it's like an Apple experience, which is quite amazing. I think GBK have done a really good job, but it just presents itself, this burger, which is like a magic box. And also ZZ Super interesting. So they've got like a double-decker pizza thing going on that's got its own little shelf. It's like a car park for pizza, which kind of arrives as well, which is, you know, quite nice.
I think it's interesting. I mean, there's a lot of innovation going out. And yeah. there needs to be because, as I said before, you know, if you've got essentially a flat market, which yeah. is still a big market, don't yeah. get me wrong, this is a substantial market and a good market to be in eating and drinking out. But there's not a lot of, you know... organic growth, so it's a matter of getting market share, and you've got to be creative, you've got to be on the front foot. And I think in terms of product, but particularly in terms of tech, there's a real opportunity. And part of it all comes back to the consumer at the end of the day, understanding who your customers are and what they do when they're not with you.
Yeah.
How do they use tech in their day-to-day lives?
Yeah. Yeah.
How do they want to use tech yeah. when they go to a restaurant or for a takeaway or whatever, which will be different. And I think the issue now is how can you wrap tech around, particularly in restaurants and pubs, around that human interaction, which is the essence of going out for a beer or a meal yeah. with your friends or your family.
Yeah, yeah.
How much can it intrude, which you can probably do more if you're in fast food,
yeah.
and how much do you want to keep it out? But it's going to be there because, one, consumers want to use tech, and our research shows, you know, CJ research shows that. But the other thing is there's a need for tech back of house, because with increased costs, which restaurants and pubs are having to deal with in terms of food inflation, staff costs, and property costs, particularly business rates, they've got to find efficiencies. So tech, it may not be a core skill for the market, but it's something people have got to get their heads around. And I think the most innovative companies are the ones who've got tech
yeah.
high up the agenda. And you've just mentioned a few.
Yeah, definitely. And I think, you know, credit to you guys at, you know, at CGA. I think you gave a lot of people confidence in that room at 2020, you know, the big event that you hold, where you said it's a flat market, there's just more of you.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And I think actually, because so much of the commentary is doom and gloom and all the rest of it. But it was great. I think that was a real positive highlight of the
day. Well, it is interesting every year, and we've just done it back in January, our business leaders survey, when we survey about 200 chief execs, but right across the market, corporates as well as entrepreneurs.
I don't get an invite anymore.
Oh, should ask me, you can't. But I think what's interesting there is there's real nervousness about the market. It's only about 30% of, around about 30% of those chief execs are confident about the market and where that's going. But they are confident about their own business. It leaps to 60%.
Yeah.
So we've got this interesting gap now, reality gap, between people saying, yeah, I could do this. Yeah. We're going to be fine, but yeah. I'm not sure about them. You know, which is essentially what they're saying. So how that works, if everybody is on the front foot, you know, it's good news for the market. But I think it's safe to say people are quite realistic and should be concerned, because there are more costs. There is more uncertainty with Brexit. You can't get away from it.
No.
And no one quite knows what's going to happen. And the market is flat. There's no organic growth.
Yeah.
But the good thing, and you've just highlighted, is a lot of people doing some really interesting stuff, both in pubs and in restaurants yeah. and in coffee bars
yeah.
and in fast food.
Well, I think the you know, one of the big things, again, was just in terms of that competition piece. And what's a lovely thing about our industry is that actually people get together and, you know, they work together
yeah.
to help people get... No other industries like that.
I think that is really interesting, and I've known that for all those years I've been around, and it goes back to even when we helped set up the LMR over a very, very long lunch in Mayfair in a pub, I hasten to add. But yes, people are collegiate. They do work together. They compete like mad, but actually they do share ideas or whatever. And not that I've particularly worked in other industries, but you always get the sense that retail is more cutthroat. People don't talk. There are certain things people won't talk about, quite rightly, but generally people are pretty open. And I think that's good. And I think that's good for the trade associations going forward, that people will work together and come in and add their weight to arguments.
So, in terms of your journey, we went off on a couple of tangents. So,
because often public do, in... which is a problem with my life. I often go off at tangents and do something, and it seems like a good idea.
It's like a Billy Connolly show,
yeah.
where it's kind of going off in the arc somewhere. So, I think so you were at Publican, LMR, and then what happened next?
Well, the LMR, we. I didn't actually work for the LMR, but we were, in a sense, back in the days at Publican with Quantum Publishing, we were the catalyst, I think, fair to say, i.e. we paid for the lunches. So, and also we came up, you know, make it simple, we'd been working with the Restaurateurs Association, we understood their constitution, and we sort of suggested the LMR take that sort of approach. That's why I'm still vice president of the LMR, well, and now on the council for the advisory council for UK hospitality, which involved getting essentially, in terms of funding, getting suppliers to fund through membership as well. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, organisations go through their phases, but it's really come together now because it's taken on the late night market. When Beda merged, it's taken on casual dining, and now the logic of putting sort of that sort of pub restaurants segment with sort of more high end restaurants, hotels and contract catering together makes a lot of sense. The challenge for UK hospitality, and I think we will meet that, is keeping it relevant to all those different strands. I think the structure is important, giving people their voice, giving their opportunity to have their say, because it's not easy holding the industry together when it's full of entrepreneurs. But, you know, I think there is a commonality, and certain campaigns will bring people together.
Yeah, I think people that choose to start restaurants and lead them are unique.
Yeah.
In lots of ways, which makes it.
But I think one of the things about the LMR's always been good over the years, it's fun too.
Yeah.
It's serious.
Yeah, yeah.
There's some serious campaign to do. Kate Nichols has done a great job on that and will continue to do that. But I think it's also, you've got to have your time off. And that's that sociability, which you should have in hospitality anyway, helps hold it together when things get tough and we've got to do some serious campaigning.
Yeah.
And hopefully that will sort of lubricate the market going forward.
Yeah. So then what was next after that?
What was next? Yeah, I mean, basically, I left Quantum. I want to do something slightly different in the publishing mode. I'd got to know private equity. And obviously, as a journalist, you're seeing those changes in the market. And we launched, Peter Coulson and I, Peter, a well-known lawyer in this sector, launched the M&C Report newsletter with some help from private equity. Got some backing from great private equity guy in a private capacity, John Moulton, and people from the industry as well helped back that. We created M&C Report, which is still the only newsletter, financially based newsletter in the sector. And I think, you know, it's something I wanted to do, but it was also of its time, because I think we were seeing the growth in those companies. We were seeing changes in markets. We were seeing changes in funding, things like securitization coming into the market. And it made sense. And I think the thing I was always trying to hold together, that actually a lot of people were looking at the market in silos, that pubs were their own market, restaurants were their own market. My view, and it still is, I think it's proved, is that it's essentially one market. You perhaps need different skills to run different types of outlets, but at the top level, it's essentially the same thing. You're running a business which provides hospitality, which provides entertainment and food and drink. So how you do it is slightly different, but the fundamentals are the same. And I think we've seen that.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we've got pub companies owning restaurants and restaurant companies owning pubs these days, let alone outlets in airports or whatever. So I think it's proved it is essentially one market. Consumers don't care.
Yeah.
As long as it's good. Is it a pub? Is it a restaurant? Doesn't matter. I've had a good time. Yeah. Is it a bar? Does it matter?
Value for money.
Yeah.
All that stuff. And I think it, one of the peach things is, as well, you know, one of the peach conferences.
Yeah, we did peach later.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So,
we created M&C Report and on the back of that, a number of awards, typical publishing approach, including Retailers Retailer, which I would say is still going well. Yeah. And we sold that to William Reid, worked for them for a while, and then it's a problem being an entrepreneur, want to go and do something else.
Yeah.
And then we launched Peach, which, as you say, we got our initials in, which is, if people don't know, and most people do know now, it's Peter and Christine.
I had no idea.
I
only found out about, you know, a couple of months ago.
But it worked, didn't it?
Yeah.
We had M&C with Peter Coulson alive,
yeah.
Which was a slight play on words with the MMC, Merger and Monopolies Commission. I think we're trying too hard there. And then Peach, it was one of those things, that's just brilliant. It's about food. It sort of worked. And it's still around.
Still
CGA still use that for the events market. Because we built that up with Peach Report and with our events, including Hero and Icon Awards and Peach 2020. And we sold that mainly because we started getting into data. And I think this is important because, you know, you can do the media stuff, you're reporting on stuff, but actually you need facts. And I think data has become more important. We started to create our own data. We did it first through Coffee Peach Business Tracker, mm-hmm. which is a very simple barometer of sales in the market. But we, because we got to that sort of C-suite, so board level, we could get those guys in to get critical mass to make mm-hmm. it work. And that's still growing. And a lot of people say it's just a big change. It's not. It is a mix of big and small chains here. But it gives us a real sense of where the market's going. We did that. And then we got into consumer research with Brand Track. And I think we've CJ, that was hopefully one of the attractions he bought us. Yeah. But again, I've continued working with them, and I've got a great relationship with CJ, and we'll continue to work. And we're seeing something like Brand Track work back into the drinks market, where CJ has historically been its strongest. But it's allowed them as a business to expand.
Yeah, and just, you know, one of the Peach things, just we were touching on value for money there, just tracking back a tiny bit, was it one of the Peach conferences, I think maybe someone from M&B was up talking.
Quite likely.
Yeah, and they were brilliant. It was, I think it was MD. And he said, just about value for money, and he said, we don't realise this being in this London bubble, but when it's the choice between buying someone a pair of football boots, you know, buying yeah. your kid football yeah. boots, and buying a meal, you better get it right. And I think, you know, a lot of us that live in a London bubble and earn more than the average or whatever, you could forget that quite easily.
Yeah.
So I thought that was a real humble point to make.
I think that's interesting, because I think one of the things, the changes we have seen, because the pub was always, going back in time, the pub was always very democratic. Anyone could go to the pub. But I think we've seen eating outs become more democratic, mm-hmm. not just through fast food, but with casual dining as well. There are different price points. But I think... And I was talking to Tim Martin about this only yesterday, actually, about, because Tim, executive chairman of Wetherspoons, goes on a lot about the threat of supermarkets, mm-hmm. and I don't think it is it's not the sole problem on pubs, but he was saying, you know, if you're in London, doesn't really matter. You know, your pub pricing doesn't matter, but there are certain parts of the country where mm-hmm. it does matter because you're making those choices. And I think now understanding price is important. However, I think you just can't go cheap and cheerful and stack it high anymore.
Yeah.
Because certainly people have budgets, they know what they're going to spend, they want to go out, but they also want quality as well. Yeah. And dare I say it, without singing Wetherspoons phrases too much, I think they have been really very good at it, because they're seen as value for money. Mm-hmm. But actually the quality of their products are incredibly mm-hmm. good. You know, Fetzer wine, Villa Maria wine, fantastic range of craft yeah. beer. So they haven't gone cheap and nasty. And yeah. I think that is a danger if you see cheapness just about price.
Yeah.
You've got to get that right. So you yeah. can't go over too much so people won't go.
Yeah.
But then again, you've still got to wow them.
Yeah.
Because dare I say, it's going to be someone else down the road who will do it.
You know? Well, and it'll take your business. And I think, you know, the Wetherspoons and McDonald's and a few others are, it's really interesting. And you changed my perceptions on that by the meetings that we had back in the old days. And you used to show me things like, you know, the audience that were really eating and drinking with Wetherspoons, McDonald's. Because when you're a brand, and we've had it with lots of our clients, you get quite snobby.
Yeah.
You know, and you say, oh no, it's only the, you know, brown leather shoes and chimney pots that come to us, and oh, they would never be seen dead in the McDonald's. You know, not that's a bad thing, but that's what a lot of brands think. And I was just, it really opened my mind, you know, yeah. when I saw your reports and your data, and you're like, well, did you know, at, you know, whichever brand, that your customers were also eating at Greg's and this yeah. and that and that, and yeah. you went, oh my God, I've just been so dumb.
But I think understanding, I think if we've done anything with that Brand Track research, it's understanding people's repertoires. Mm. And so it goes back to my point of understanding where they are when they're not with you. It's looking at what they do when they're not eating, but also the brands they go to.
Yeah.
And a lot of it is the fact that Wetherspoons and McDonald's are ubiquitous. They're very big. But they are part of people's repertoire for different occasions. You know, you may go into a McDonald's because actually the coffee's okay and you want the Wi-Fi.
Coffee's very good.
It is. It's great. And that's a whole another point about that quality. Mm-hmm. I made that point about quality. If anyone has seen that advertisement they put out, having a go at artisan coffee, Brilliant. But actually, that wasn't the point. I think the point they were making is that we do roast and ground coffee.
Yeah.
Our coffee is pretty damn good.
Yeah.
And actually, for the industry, they've got to understand that. That is now the standard.
Yeah, yeah.
If that's the standard of coffee McDonald's do, you better meet it.
Yeah.
Definitely. And it's a bit like quality of wine or beer in Wetherspoons. If it's less than that, don't
forget
bother
it.
Because this is a standard where most people will go.
Yeah.
So going back to why people go to McDonald's, it could be on, you know, kids' parties, taking kids back from football or cricket or whatever, or netball, whatever it is. Lots of different occasions. So people do use as part of the repertoire.
Yeah.
You may go into Wetherspoons for whatever reason. It may be for a meeting. It may be for an early evening bite. It may be for a pint. It may be just use their Wi-Fi.
Yeah.
Whatever it is. So, but that experience is an important part. And people are picking up experiences everywhere.
Yep.
And understanding that is goes a long way to understanding where... understanding how they're going to interact with your particular brand.
But I think what it taught me as a younger whippersnapper anyway was just don't be so personal about marketing. You know, take data and use it.
Yeah.
And be open-minded because, you know, there's a whole bunch of scenarios going on out there that isn't necessarily you.
Yeah. I think data's quite interesting. We got into it and obviously I got the CJ and they've got a massive amount. You know, there's 140 people or 150 people up in Stockport, half of them just number crunching.
I mean, cool place in Stockport, by the way.
It is Strawberry Studios. Yeah. 10cc used to own it. Yeah.
New Order, Stone Roses. I mean, my God.
Your generation.
I couldn't believe it. When I walked in, I just couldn't believe it.
But it is a historic place. Yeah. It is an amazing. It's part of historic Stockport. But you know, there's a lot of people. CJ's a pretty big business now. I mean, doing acquisitions. It's got a business in the States. First company to measure drink there. But actually, the interesting about that data, and it comes from all different sources, from EPOS, from wholesalers. But for someone like me with a journalistic background, it's about taking that data and trying to create a narrative, trying to use that data to understand how this market works. And the more you look, the more questions you ask and the more data you need. But I think it is that's a fascinating thing now. You know, it's not just about people giving numbers, but it's saying, what do these numbers mean? How do they affect your business? And what CGA's role really is to provide that benchmark for people's internal, because a lot of people got their internal data.
Yeah.
But the other thing is, we would never say at CGA, only use data. You've got to use your own experience, but it's a matter of putting all that together and creating it and trying to understand how consumers work, how your brands work.
Yeah. I mean, I think the big thing is, you know, having been in a few companies, you know, inside and out and all the rest of it, I see so much of the time people doing the data bit very well, but not the narrative. It's like, we've got more data, we know what to do with, And they don't take the time to understand
that is a fair criticism, because a lot of people say, we've got more data we need. Well, actually, that's not, in a sense, not the point. You know, what we will say to it, so what do you want out of this? And so you can help create the sort of dashboards or data feeds people want. Yeah. But actually, it is understanding and putting stuff together. It's quite interesting. One of the things we've been looking at recently is the fundamental experience of eating and drinking out is really that interaction between your waiting staff, your serving staff, your bar staff, and the customer.
Yeah.
That's fundamental, right? Okay, so people will measure satisfaction and whatever metrics they'll use on consumers. Mm-hmm. And then increasingly, people quite rightly are getting a sense of what their staff engagement is, you know, how happy they are, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But a couple of things. Even now, this industry has still got a long way to go on people, and they can do it. Because we did a bit of research off business leaders, which actually showed that the most common way of understanding how your staff are feeling is the exit interview, which is a bit late, really. No names, but generally it's still seen there. And that's not good enough. And the other thing is, very few companies still put two bits of data together, staff engagement against customer satisfaction. They should be linked, surely,
because
that's what the product is, essentially.
Yeah.
And it's thinking like that, I think. So, you know, there's some other data you probably don't need, but understanding core things like that. Now, there may be other areas people need to understand, but it's a matter of understanding what do you want to understand, What do you want to know? And then get the data to look at that.
Well, it's interesting you're saying about employee engagement, and there's a lot going on that, like that at the moment, where, you know, Brexit and the B word and all these things, and where, and also it's tough out there and all these things, you know. So from that point of view, it's like people are needing to hang on to the good people, you know. So how do you do that?
Yeah.
And I think there's a big, you know, sort of responsibility for all of us to educate people of why it's more than a job and why it's more than a wage, you know. So what's their role in life? What are they really achieving?
Yeah.
And what we're sort of finding is, it's quite interesting, you know, just when you're saying about it's the exit interview. So we, you know, we're actually getting lots and lots of calls about it, and we've got a few clients on the go, you know, doing people stuff, which is all part of brand, you know. It's not a brand department thing. So when we were looking at that, you know, we're sort of thinking, well, how do you get them engaged? And then, so if everyone's face is stuck to the phone, then there's, you know, great apps that are starting, like Yapstar and all these things, you know, how you can communicate with your team. But one point someone made, it's one of these LinkedIn videos, but they said, and you know, youth, children go through school every day teaching. And then after school, you might go to college or university, but then that's it. So as a employer, when was the last time you sat down every single day and just kept drumming home this message about, so you do maybe an employee engagement session once every 3 years, 5 years, you do an induction, you might do an employee survey twice a year if you're lucky, but the turnover's happening faster than that. So I think a lot of things would be solved, that you could spend much less money on recruitment and marketing, in fact, if you just told people what they were there for.
Yeah. You know? I think that's a very good point, because I think there's not one way, but it is a matter of, you know, staff are going to be at a premium. We know that, or at least we're assuming that, and it's right to assume it's going to get more difficult to recruit staff because there's going to be fewer of them. And so how do you hang on to it? You're absolutely right, but I think there's lots of different ways of doing it. But they need to be valued, they need to be listened to. But also the other thing is, I think you're quite right, is, you know, goes back to what you do. What is the brand essence? What are we about? And making sure they understand that, for one thing. But also getting that feedback, talking to them. And a lot of it can be done remotely through technology, but also there's a great value of the fact that senior management actually go and talk to them.
Yeah.
Go around pubs.
Yeah.
You know, it's the old thing about managing by walking about.
Yes.
It's not as easy if you've got an estate of pubs and restaurants, but it is by travelling around.
Yeah.
And understanding, talking, not to go and give them a hard time, but actually sometimes just listen and find out, you know. And I think there's lots of ways to do it. And again, there's this sort of, you know, hard and soft ways of doing things. It's like with data, you need numbers, but you also need that instinct as well. So it's that melded approach.
Yeah.
And I think if you see the, if you, without any name, you see the good companies, you could tell a lot by their bosses.
Yes. Yeah. And it completely stems from there. You know, you look at, well, the Pretz of this world and how wonderful Clive is, you know, and things like that. You know, it's a huge...
I mean, I think Pret's a very good example about how development is, because we know, you know, what they did with Veggie Pret and going green on that, and that was Clive backing that as a sort of almost skunk works operation to do it, you know, away from the main business. It worked, and then that's developed, and they put vegan lines back into the main brand, and that was, in a sense, that's an interesting trend as well. So you sort of skip vegetarianism straight to veganism.
Yeah. So let's talk about trends then. So you are the trendsetter.
Not at my age. I don't set any trends anymore. Don't worry.
Those are some funky specs you've got.
There's a story there.
Okay, that'll be the next podcast. So what's going on right now and in the near future? What are you seeing right now, and what do you think?
Well, I think the vegan thing was quite interesting, because I think, in terms of eating out, I think we have seen this tipping point, sort of changing the balance between health and indulgence. It's always there within in the market about why people go out for a good time of health. And we've certainly seen that health has become more and more important. It's picked up by... And I think what we saw this year in business leaders, all of a sudden, the market gets it, operators get it. So vegan lines are now seen as the most important food trend amongst, I mean, that's an amazing. Yeah. I mean, I think I said in November at Peach 2020, it's a thing now.
Oh, yeah.
And all of a sudden, it is a thing now. Mm. And I think we've seen January, but also what Pret's doing. I think you've seen brands like Lyon, which has been always been seen as a bit London and quirky, is now mainstream.
Mm.
And I think you can argue, has the market come to Lyon or has Lyon come to the market? It's probably a bit of both.
Mm.
But all of a sudden, you know, this is mainstream yeah. business now. And it's not just in London, you know, it's international. And in Scotland.
And Scotland.
Even in Scotland.
Yeah.
And so that health things move. Now, it doesn't mean to say all the barbecue trends are over, but because if they're good and authentic, they'll be fine. Mm-hmm. But I think it's a matter of how that balance has gone. I think the other thing is we see from consumers they want something new more. And we're seeing this both in what's happening in terms of outlets and brands, and we're seeing that in food choices as well. Drink, what's drink about? It's about premiumization. Mm-hmm. The fundamental message of the drinks business, alcohol business, is people are drinking less, but they're drinking better. Mm-hmm. So the value, the volume of alcohol sold in this country is going down.
Yeah, because quality's up.
The value is going up.
Yeah. So just on that point then, is craft over?
No, I don't think it's over. It will evolve, and it may come up as something slightly new.
Yeah.
I mean, I think the craft revolution is quite interesting, actually, because one could argue that the whole microbrewery craze started some time back, which was driven by Camra.
Yeah.
Because it was Camra. I know it's all about cask beer, but it was still about quality.
Yeah.
The interest in beers with beer writers like Michael Jackson, Roger Protz, my old friend I used to work with, is increase that knowledge about beer. So there was that. But then we got, and it is those tipping points you can never quite tell. Mm. This is why it's always interesting. This. Yeah. You can never always predict it.
So, just to interrupt.
Yeah.
Like, going back, who were the forefathers of this then? So in the cask thing, who were the ones that were original craft back then?
Well, Camra was actually, and you can't dismiss Camra, because I sort of have a bit of a love-hate relationship with Camra, because I think sometimes it is a bit old school and it's a bit nostalgic. Mm. But also, from those early guys, you've got people like Chris Hutt, who went into building pub chains, free houses, Camra Real Ale Investments, became one of the great pub operators, chairman of Geronimo. And that came out of that, bringing new blood into the pub market, but also brewing side. A guy called Chris Holmes did a similar thing. Both were ex-national chairman of Camra. Chris Holmes set up a pub chain, then bought into a brewery, which is Castle Rock.
Yeah.
But there are a lot going on there. I mean, you had breweries. I mean, Butcombe now is seen as mainstream. Well, that was sort of a new brewery. You know, Ringwood, you know, mainstream. No, that was a real brewery. Hobgoblin. Those guys were entrepreneurial businesses, started up from nothing on the back of Camra. So in a sense, it's not new, but we're talking about craft now because it's got that extra impetus because of what's been happening in the States. And I think also because of the taste profile of the beers coming out. It's not all about cask beer and hand pumps, which is perhaps seen as a bit old. You can get good quality beer back on keg now.
Mm-hmm.
And it is that hoppier, really more astringent taste is actually changing taste profiles in the pub and beer industry. So I think sometimes it's a matter of that second wave or even almost third wave has got really people interested.
Yeah.
Now, most of those brewers will do craft beer and cask beer. Yeah. And what's the difference? In some senses, there's no difference at all. But a lot is imagery, so you go along with it because that's got the interesting in from consumers. So I think, where is it going? I mean, I think there is a sense that perhaps some of the big international brewers are calling everything craft. That could change it. But actually, within their portfolios, a lot of them have got some very good beers. Let's face it, you know, the Brooklyns and the Goose Islands of this world are owned by big international brewers, but the beer's still damn good.
But I think that was possibly done in the right way, in that they were independent first and then kind of got bought.
Yes, exactly.
I think,
and they weren't consumed back in, but we'll see.
And then I think when you see the bigger brewers sort of trying to do it under a different guise, and it's all a bit funky. You're a bit like, you know, as a consumer. You're
But I think what's happening at the next phase now, you're seeing, say, some of the family brewers here, people like Fuller's, who are doing lots of great cooperative work with other brewers like Thornbridge or whatever. I think those collaborations are really interesting, and it adds interest back into the pub market. And I think that's what consumers want.
Yeah.
There is that sense that people want reassurance, but they also want something new. Yeah. So again, it's difficult. How do you get that right? And I think, pubs are no longer just about selling one brewer's beer.
Yeah, and I think big plaudits to Fuller's as well, because we got a couple of cases for Christmas, which was nice of the Fuller's and Friends. They were delicious. But also, George over there, the female head brewer, just doing an amazing job. She's really leading the market, which is great.
And
to
again,
see.
You talked about passion earlier, and you're seeing that passion coming through. So it is there, but it's probably, you still got to have it in a commercial environment. But actually, I think we are seeing much more of that, and I think that giving people their head, giving people the ability to be passionate, I think it is crucial. Again, we're seeing a food with street food, not dissimilar.
Yeah. Just sticking with the beers for a sec, then. Obviously, we've had some latest news on BrewDog and Drafthouse getting together.
That's an interesting move. Yeah.
Yeah. What's your take on that?
Well, I think it makes perfect sense because BrewDog. It's a big business these days. They're trying to still stay edgy, and they are. But actually, it's a way of getting them more outlets. But I think they've always been good. It's not just about BrewDog brands. They're not doing the old Tide House system.
Yes.
We have pumps of our own, but we'll also have something new in. We'll do beer cocktails. Not a massive fan of beer cocktails, personally, but not the point.
Yeah.
And I think that, if they use that to work with other brewers and have other brewers in, I think that's good news. And Draft House has got itself a really good footprint, particularly here in London.
It's absolutely pretty much one of my favourite pubs to go to. Certainly one in Hammersmith I love to bits. And
one on Charlotte Street.
I think, congrats to Charlie. I think he's done a great job, and so I'll be interested to see. I hope it lives on, and it's just part of...
But I think it goes back to, it's the evolution. I think what we've got in this market is, if we're looking at sites and brands, you've got to evolve. You've got to move forward. The trick is, how do you keep your core brand identity and stay relevant to the market and add new stuff in? And that's the balance. The interesting thing is where people like you, brand gurus, come in to do. I think that is the point, because there are some really strong brands in the market. I mean, in terms of homegrown ones, Nando's, you could argue, is South African, but it's really grown in Britain.
Yeah.
Wetherspoons, when comedians stand up at the Hammersmith Apollo and take the piss out of you, you've made it. Because now Wetherspoons and Nando's are part of day-to-day parlance in this country. And to get that is a massive act. It doesn't really matter what they say about you, but you made it. And I think that's interesting for this business. Didn't used to happen.
What happened with them, I nearly posted the clip, we maybe should, was Ramesh Ranganathan stood up at the Apollo, and he did about 5 minutes on Wagamama.
Yeah.
And
well,
he
there
was
you go.
Talking about them scribbling on the...
Wagger's got it. Yo's got it.
Yeah,
it's
just fantastic to see. I think that's
and that's
cool
when you're a real brand.
Definitely. So then, sort of looking ahead, then the next couple of years, things that you want to achieve, and also what do you think is going to happen in the market? And
let's talk about the market. I think the market is still here. I mean, there's a bit of doom and gloom because of what we've seen with Jamie's and some of the other restaurant chains closing sites. I think we'll have that churn. And in fact, a lot of pub chains have been doing it for years because it makes sense not to overextend and to make sure you get the right sites. And data can help on that. That's another plug.
Yeah.
No, but it can help on doing that and getting it right. And understanding, and not being necessarily driven by private equity saying this is where we need to go. Because I think that you've got to match your brand to your customers. That brand may evolve or it may stay the same. It depends often on your ambition for your individual business. What do you want to be, a national brand, or do you want to be more niche?
Yeah,
nothing wrong with either. But it's understanding what you want to achieve and then how you do it. So I think we're going to see still more excitement. I think we'll see tipping points we didn't know. Street food's interesting. Street food got serious in this country, because people would be able to buy food off the street for years. But when people like Jonathan Downey set up London, well, Dinorama and London Union, almost organised it into a venue. And you look at Dinorama, his new place in Woolwich, or Giant Robot, you know, it's food and drink together. They're bringing in new entrepreneurs in street food, which is great, which is another area of how do you encourage new people. But essentially, they're just big pubs.
Yeah.
And that's not being disparaging, it's amazing. It's food and drink, entertainment experience, people coming together, having a great time.
Yeah. He's got to be celebrated, you know, Jonathan. You know, terms of, you know, how much he's just been a bit of a maverick. He's kind of out of the sector in a way, on his own, creating these things from nothing. Obviously with the group round about him, but, you know, just wow
but,
stuff.
But done it also with commercial reality as well, because need that, you know.
Yeah.
And then people can come in, you know, if you want to be serious, a lot of those street food guys can go on and into bigger things, and they go into bricks and mortar and off.
Yeah.
Or you just stay in doing what you're doing. It doesn't really matter, you know, because it's what you want to do.
Yeah.
But there are ways and means of becoming big. Doesn't mean it's always easy, and there will be failures.
Yeah.
You know, it's the capitalist system. There will be failures. But there's a lot of options. And the other thing which will go around that, I think the whole food tech area is really interesting. A lot of – I do a fair bit of work with the guys at London Food Tech Week. And what you see there is new entrepreneurs, young entrepreneurs in their 20s and 30s with new ideas about whether it's urban farms, whether it's waste management, all sorts of things going on. Mm-hmm. Some will work, some won't.
Yeah.
But there's that innovation and excitement. And actually, you asked me what I'm doing. So I'm still working with CGA on that data. Because, one, they're growing. Two, that data provides me with an awful lot of sort of basis for creating these narratives. Mm-hmm. But also, I'm now with CM&Co doing more consultancy, working with younger companies, working with a couple of tech companies from the States now. One very interesting, doing voice-activated ordering. You know, so we're going to see. We talked about delivery. Well, it could add something new there. Yeah. How that's going to happen? For example, if you've got Alexa or whatever in your car, and that's going to happen, most cars going to have it standard. How do people interact with that? How does this industry interact? So I'm working with a company which thinks it's got the answer.
Well, it's so interesting, voice, and you know, I'm a huge fan of Gary Vaynerchuk on the web, and he's, you know, one of the leading lights on digital and stuff like this. And he was doing a fantastic, if you haven't checked it out, he's doing it with Danny Mayer.
Great. Danny's great.
So the podcast, it's a video as well, so it's about an hour, but just full of great stuff, right? But part of it, he's saying to Danny, do you remember when I set you up on Twitter? And he's like, oh yeah, it was a brilliant moment for me, and, you know, and it really changed my life. And he's like, right, we're about to have that moment again, but we're going to do it on voice. So he's got Alexa there. And he's saying, Alexa, tell me the best whatever in New York, and the answers don't come back. And he said, right, I'm going to do that video in 2 years, same questions.
Yeah.
And it's going to be full of stuff. So I think getting your voice acting gear is got to be massive. Yeah. And at the very least, just to create some PR.
Yeah.
You know, but yeah, everyone's missing that opportunity at the moment. There's not many on there, is there?
No, not at all.
No, so I think that's
really in the UK.
So, no, definitely.
It's starting in the States now, and that's interesting. And I think the other, you know, there's a lot, again, it's that tech and people stuff. There's all sorts of areas which are really quite interesting. I think the trick is, how can I help those companies, but also how can I write about them, talk about them? Because the other thing is, how do people get to know what the hell's going on? Podcasts like yours are great. but it is about curating that information, because you say there's a lot of data about, there's also a lot of information about, because there's an awful lot of stuff going on. And I still think, you know, from my point of view, it's still a way of bringing out together. We tend to do it through live events probably more than the printed word these days, but that's great. Getting people together, talking about what's happening in the industry, still keeps you going.
Yeah.
Well, and not just in this country, in the States as well.
Definitely. And the live events have just been so valuable to me, you know, either as a speaker or as a listener or whatever. And, you know, every time I just pick up so much gold from it that I can then dine off of selfishly for the next little while. Always give credit to what people are saying. But, you know, I just think, you know, if anyone listening, you know, wants to look at the peach marketing events or the 2020s of this world or anything, you know, just really check it out, because there's so much great stuff going on every single time. You know, it never gets old. Never gets old.
Well, that's no pressure on me. Thank you.
So any sort of final thoughts that you'd sort of give out as, you know, kind of messages to people in the market?
Well, I suppose the final thoughts is I'm still doing it because it's a great market to work in, which says something. And I think it is a great market to work in, the eating and drinking out market. But as I said before, you know, it's not easy, it's tough, but it's a lot of fun. And it is not going to go away. It will change.
Yeah.
Not everyone will succeed.
Yeah.
But that need to go out, not just to eat and drink, but to meet people, I think is pretty fundamental. And I hope, this is not a bad prediction, I it will continue. And I hope it will prosper going forward.
Excellent. Well, Peter, thank you so much for coming in today. Yeah, we probably want to get out of this sweaty
nice
box.
Nice hut, this. Very good. Listen, we're both losing some weight out of here. That's great. Great, Mark. Great to see you.
Yeah, thanks so much. Have a great lunch.
I will.
And yeah, we'll definitely have you on again soon.
Thank you.
Thank you. A huge, huge thank you to Peter Martin of CGA and CM & Co., for coming in to share his knowledge and his wisdom and his great stories about the food, drink and pub industries. There's going to be links in the podcast notes if you want to check out some more information. Also, please don't forget to rate, review, share and subscribe to the Spectacular Marketing Podcast if you have some time. A huge thanks to the exec production team, Gabby, Gaz and Michal, for helping me put this all together. I'm Mark McCulloch, and this was Spectacular.